Good evening, I'm Cherie Palello. Ohio voters are going to be deciding one of the most important races in the country in just a few weeks. And for the next two nights, we're focusing on that race for Ohio's Senate seat between Republican JD Vance and Democrat Tim Ryan. Now, recently, I sat down with each of the candidates by virtue of a coin toss. We're going to start with JD Vance, a first-time politician, business owner, born and raised in Middletown, Ohio. Let's get started here. This is the race that people all across the country, not just in Ohio, are watching. And I was just looking at some of the polls just last night. There's a new poll out by Monmouth University, found 82% of Americans ranked inflation as an extremely or very important issue to them. In Ohio, I was just looking, gas prices from week to week have already jumped 25 cents here. So if you were the senator right now here in Ohio, what would you do so that families could feel some immediate relief? I mean, people are having trouble paying their bills, their monthly bills, let alone any extras.
Yeah, well, I think there are a couple of things you could do to provide immediate relief. You know, one, you could do a payroll tax cut or a payroll tax holiday so that people have more money in their pocket. But unless you solve the long-term issue, no matter how much you give people, it's going to get gobbled up by the inflation, right? If you give people a $200 tax cut, but $500 additionally goes to gas over the next year, they're not better off in the long run. So you really have to fix the energy policy here. If you remember when Joe Biden came into office on day one, he said he was going to close down the Keystone XL pipeline. He did so. Oil prices have been going up pretty much from the day that he took office. So this is a very direct consequence of the policies that Joe Biden pursued. And unfortunately, when that happens, it's not just gas that goes up, because everything relies on energy. So food goes up, right? The cost of farmers goes up. The cost of manufacturing things goes up. That's why inflation has gotten so bad, is because we pursued an energy policy where we're on our knees begging Venezuela and Saudi Arabia to give us the stuff that we have in our own backyard. I mean, Ohio could be the Saudi Arabia of the next generation of energy if we let it. Unfortunately, we don't have those policies in place right now.
One thing that I do find common ground on, and maybe you do too, both you and Tim Ryan talk about both cutting taxes. How much of a tax cut would you like to see, and how soon?
Well, I'd like to see an immediate tax cut. I mean, a payroll tax cut really hits people's paychecks instantaneously. That's one of the advantages of it. But I have to say that, you know, Tim Ryan, as much as he talks on the campaign about supporting tax cuts, he's never voted for a middle-class tax cut. He's voted for a number of middle-class tax increases. And just a few weeks ago, he voted to raise taxes on the middle class by $20 billion. So one of the things I'm trying to tell people is you got to look at people's records, not just what they say they want to do when they're asking for your vote, but what they've done, Tim Ryan's case, over a 20-year career in Washington. This guy is not a tax cutter. This guy is not a guy who supported the policies that are going to bring down prices and bring down costs for Ohio families. And so we really have to hold him accountable, not just for what he says, but for what he's done and failed to do.
He specifically talked with me about raising taxes to the wealthy. And I said to him, listen, you're going to have a lot of people out there who say, I did things the right way. Sure. I went to college. I built a business. I already pay the most in taxes. Sure. And you're going to tax me more. Who would you tax?
Sure. Yeah, so I actually ran in a Republican primary, which is not easy to do, on the plan of raising taxes on companies that ship jobs overseas. Because look, if you're doing business with communist China, you do not deserve to benefit from the low taxes and the regulatory environment that we have here in this country. So I think that's one place to start. If you look at our digital technology companies versus our manufacturers in Ohio, one of the crazy things you see is that Apple, Amazon, Google, Facebook, they all pay a way lower tax rate than Ohio manufacturers. But those Ohio manufacturers are, one, making things that we need, and two, providing middle-class jobs to people here in this state. So when people say we need to raise taxes on the wealthy, my question is, who, right? And my answer is, we need to raise taxes on the companies that aren't paying their fair share, that aren't creating jobs here in Ohio. And I think that's a very straightforward thing to do. It's just about making it more fair. I don't think that you need to punish anyone. You just need to make the tax system more fair. And unfortunately, it's not fair right now. And I have to go back to this. One of the major changes in tax law in the last year and a half under the Biden administration, of course, supported by Tim Ryan, is that we raise taxes on Ohio manufacturers, a catastrophically bad tax increase. Because again, we're not talking about the big guys out in Silicon Valley. We're talking about the guys who create jobs right here in Ohio. You raise their taxes, you drive up costs, and you put a lot of people out of work. So we got to be careful about how we do this.
Shifting gears here, let's talk about the relationship and your connection to former President Trump. Before getting his endorsement, it seemed like you were kind of keeping him at a distance or distancing yourself from him. What changed?
Well, I don't think that I was keeping my distance or embracing. I was just trying to tell the truth, right? And I was actually a critic of Donald Trump in 2016. I did not think he was going to be a great president. I was very happy to be proven wrong. I think if you look at the prosperity that we had in this country, the rising wages, the fact that we were finally starting to take on China, I think those policies really worked for working people in our state. And so I was very open about the fact that, look, I wasn't a big Trump guy in 2016, but I think he did a good job. That's why I supported him in 2020. And I think the recognition that I changed my mind is one of the reasons why the president came in and endorsed me. I think it was helpful to the race, and I think will continue to be helpful to us. Because really, look, I understand some people don't like the rhetoric, right? That's a constant criticism I hear about President Trump. The question I'd ask people is, do we want to go back to the prosperity, to the rising wages, to kids thriving, or do we want to live the last 18 months of rising prices, rising crime, a wide open southern border? Whatever you think of the rhetoric, the policies were working for us here in Ohio, and we've got to get back to something like that if we want to restore not just prosperity, but security.
I'm glad you brought up the rhetoric, because I think that's a sticking point for people, right? I think a lot of people, they either love or hate him, right? And the fact that you support him for some people is enough to say, he's not going to get my vote. If you vote for Trump, I'm not going to vote for you. If they are more, even people who are more moderate. Sure. What do you say to those voters?
Well, look, I understand where they're coming from. And at the end of the day, I am my own man. I'm running on my own ideas. I'm running on my own policies and platform for how we can make this state more prosperous and more secure. And I guess the main thing that I'd say to them is, look, would you rather have a guy who's honest about making a mistake about changing their mind? Or would you rather have a guy like Tim Ryan, who supported a lot of really bad policies for this state, and then says in his TV commercials that he loves Donald Trump? It's kind of a weird thing, right? If you don't like Donald Trump, then why are you supporting a political candidate, Tim Ryan, who pretends that he's a Republican, even though his voting record is 100% Democratic? And I think that dishonesty is what really separates Tim Ryan from me, at least when it comes to our approach to President Trump. My basic argument is there are three really big things we have to do. We have to get back to a closed border, to security, to the end of this fentanyl crisis. We have to get back to safety on our streets. I mean, we have skyrocketing crime. This is not just a New York or a San Francisco problem. It's a Cincinnati, it's a Columbus, it's a Cleveland problem. And we've got to get back to bringing prices down for families so they can go to the grocery store without breaking the bank.
After the break, I asked JD Vance about three of the biggest issues on the minds of so many of you voters: abortion, immigration, and gun violence. I would say second to inflation, the number one reason people are going to go out to the polls this November is the abortion issue. More states, including Ohio, are moving in the direction of banning all abortions with very narrow exceptions. My question to you is, what do you say to women who say you shouldn't be making that type of medical decision, that type of family decision for me? So where specifically do you stand on this issue? And if you want to ban abortions, would you make any exceptions?
Well, look, I am pro-life, and of course you have to provide reasonable exceptions. I think what I really like to do here is save as many lives as possible. That's really my view. If you look at our infant mortality rates here in the state of Ohio, they're really high, especially for, you know, poor white kids who grew up like I did, poor black families, really high infant mortality rates. We have a terrible healthcare system in this country where, you know, people go and deliver a baby and they have $30,000 of medical bills. I think we have to fix these things to create the kind of culture, to create the kind of society that's more welcoming to young mothers and more welcoming to young families. And I guess the other argument I'd make is, look, I understand I'm pro-life. There are people who are going to disagree with me on that issue. I can respect that disagreement. But there's also a compare and contrast thing going on here, which is Tim Ryan is not just pro-choice. He's defended abortions elective up to 40 weeks of gestation, and he wants Ohio taxpayers to fund that stuff. And so the real extremist on the abortion issue in this race is unfortunately Tim Ryan. And I can accept, again, people are going to draw the line differently from how I'm going to draw it, but we should not be drawing the line at 40 weeks of gestation abortion and having Ohio taxpayers fund it. I think that's crazy. I think that's objectively not something that 95% of Ohio wants to do. And frankly, it's something no civilized country in the world allows.
Would you make exceptions for rape and incest?
Like I said, I mean, the thing I try to do is bring this from generalities into the very specific situations. So if you take, for example, this 10-year-old girl, the case that everybody's talking about here in Ohio, where looks like this 10-year-old girl was raped, very tragic, very, very sad situation. You know, I'm the daughter of a very young baby girl, and I just can't imagine what that's like as a father, certainly not as a child. I think that girl, under Ohio law, was actually able to get an abortion, and I think that's a reasonable exception to make, absolutely. I also think that the media has to be a little bit more honest about what's going on in that particular case. Why was there an illegal immigrant raping a 10-year-old girl in our state? Why was that person here in the state to begin with? And why was that person effectively welcomed by Joe Biden and Tim Ryan's immigration policy? So I think if you really zoom out here, what you see is, yes, I'm willing to make accommodations for these really, really unfortunate circumstances, but I'd also like to ask, why was that person in this state in the first place?
You talked about crime, and you and I were talking about it before we started our interview. I don't know if you've seen it, but recently we had a young college student who was killed here in Cincinnati in a hit and run crash. We ended up finding out days later that the 17-year-old who was the one who was arrested had run over a deputy in Northern Kentucky about a year earlier, actually faced an attempted murder charge before then pleading it out and not even going to jail. So what would you do with these young offenders? Where's the line between punishment and rehabilitation?
Well, I think you have to draw the line when it comes to really violent, gruesome crime. If you're committing murders, if you're committing assaults, if you're throwing an elderly woman on the pavement and you're mistreating that person, you need to go to prison, and you need to go to prison for a long time. And this is where I think the crime policies of me and Tim Ryan are really different here. This is a guy who, at the height of all of the rioting, the looting a couple of years ago, was basically saying that law enforcement, our police officers, were the new Jim Crow, they're systemically racist, and he was actually encouraging a lot of policies that would have beat up on our police officers while simultaneously letting a lot of violent criminals out of prison. I believe in rehabilitation, I believe in second chances, but if you're running over an innocent person with your car, you need to go to prison. I think the first step of rehabilitation for a very violent offender is actually suffering some consequences, and unfortunately, in this state and in this country, we've really gotten away from being willing to punish people who commit these gruesome crimes. We know from the statistics that if you look, whether it's Cincinnati or New York, wherever you are, in any given big city, most of the violent crime is committed by a very, very small number of people. The reason why we have a rise in violent crime is we're not willing enough to throw those people away, lock them away for at least long enough for them to have learned a lesson, and that's why we see violent crime on the rise in our cities.
Speaking of violence, you know, every day, 3 to 4 Americans under the age of 18 die from gun violence.
Sure.
We just saw what happened in Uvalde, Texas. clearly schools cannot guarantee that our kids are safe when they go
sure.
away. When it comes to the Second Amendment, what do you say to the people who are okay with the average rifle and pistol? Ryan says, hey, I'm a hunter. Yep. I want you to be able to go sure. out. I'm not trying to take away your gun rights, but they are against assault rifles and the mass ammunition that we saw that suspect in the sure. Uvalde shooting had right after turning 18. Should that be protected under the Second Amendment? Because as we saw just actually recently in Las Vegas with that stabbing, the mass stabbing that we saw, only a few people died, right?
Sure.
Compared to if he would have had some sort of assault rifle weapon, we could have had 20 people killed.
Of course, and we've also seen that circumstances, of course, where somebody runs over, you just mentioned somebody runs over somebody with their car, that terrible person in Wisconsin who I think killed 8 or 9, mostly little kids. So we have a real problem with violence, and most of it is gun violence. But if you look statistically, I think we have to, if we're going to solve the problem, we have to balance Second Amendment, which I very strongly believe in, with our security interests and making sure our people are kept safe. And if you look at most of the gun crime in this country, it's committed with pistols. And it's very often committed by violent criminals, people who already have convictions with pistols. So the things that often make the headlines, the assault rifles, you know, where 15 or 20 innocent people get killed, most of the gun violence is actually the day-to-day stuff that we see in cities like Cincinnati, where, you know, overnight, 3 or 4 or 5, 6, 7, 8 people get shot. That's the violent crime problem that we really, really have to focus on.
But mass shootings are out of control.
Mass shootings absolutely are a problem. Of course they are. I'm just saying we've got to recognize that when we talk about the big gun violence problem in our country, there's a separate side of this problem that the media doesn't focus on as much, but is actually where most of the gun crime and most of the violence and the murders come from. My own view here is that if you look, so you take the Uvalde thing, for example, that person should not have been able to get a gun, but was able to pass a background check. That person had multiple people who said he's mentally unstable, he's got real issues, and nobody responded to them. And I guess my question here, and it's more difficult, is what new law would have prevented the shooting in Uvalde? Or is it that we need to better enforce and be a little bit more careful about our mental health system to prevent this stuff from happening in the first place? There was another terrible shooting in Chicago. And what I found really depressing about that, frankly, aside from the terrible violence, is that all of the things that people say that we should do to prevent gun violence are actually in place in Chicago, and yet you still had that terrible shooting there. I think 6 or so people were killed, or at least 6 or so people were shot. Why is it that we're focused on the things that aren't going to make a difference instead of the harder things like fixing our mental health system that I think will actually make a difference? That's where I think we should focus.
We were talking about immigration a few minutes ago. Sure. Migrants flown to Martha's Vineyard and elsewhere, Republican Governor DeSantis and Abbott saying that it shows Democrats what it's like firsthand to deal with the immigration issue that they have to deal with, border states have to deal with on a day-to-day basis. Do you believe, though, that that was the right way to handle it? After all, these are real people we're talking about.
Of course, they are real people, and it's certainly tragic. You never want to use anybody as a political football, but I actually think in that case it was justified. And the reason it was justified is because, look, these states are saying, we're overwhelmed. What do we do with these people? Well, there's a place up here that has a lot of money, a lot of people who say they're welcoming to illegal immigrants. Let's send a few up there and see if those people can absorb them. And it turns out they can't. It turns out it's really disruptive to even take 50 people into your community who are unplanned. And I think the response to that, both from the media, but also from the citizens of Martha's Vineyard, was really instructive, because 50 people was treated by the entire national news as a major crisis. These people who are very rich, Martha's Vineyard is one of the richest parts of our entire country, were acting like this was a major crisis. And yet you have 2 million people in South Texas. You have a terrible fentanyl problem in Ohio because of what's going on at the southern border. The media doesn't cover that. I'm not talking about you, of course, I'm talking about the national press. And I think that just goes to show that the media is not focused enough on the real immigration problem here, which is the millions of undocumented people and the fentanyl that so many of them are bringing across the southern border.
Up next, I asked Vance about the security of our election system and how he's going to work to bring this country together. I believe you had denied at one point the results of the 2020 election. Will you accept the results of this Senate race no matter what happens?
Oh, of course I will. Of course I will. I think I'm going to win, and I'll accept the results of the election no matter what. And I think, by the way, Ohio has much better elections than some of our peer states, and that's a credit to our Secretary of State, Frank LaRose. But what I've said about the election is actually, I think, very common sense. Everybody gets obsessed with the vocabulary, right? Was the election stolen? Was the election rigged? Was the election perfect? What I try to focus on is the problems. One, we don't have voter ID in this country. Most civilized countries have voter ID. Number two, we know now, even Mark Zuckerberg, the CEO of Facebook, said that the leadership of the FBI was telling him to censor stories that were negative about Joe Biden. You can't have a real democracy if multinational corporations are censoring the flow of information for one political party. So whatever people want to call it, I think that we have problems and we need to solve those problems. And that's really where I'm focused. I don't care what people call the 2020 election. What I do care about is Mark Zuckerberg should not be censoring information about an election in the run-up to the vote.
Yes or no, you believe Joe Biden did win the election or President Trump?
Joe Biden is the president. Now, what I think, and he is the president. He's in the Oval Office. I'm not doubting the legitimacy of Joe Biden as president. What I will say is that if I think the technology companies had not censored so much information, I think independent analysis suggests the vote could have gone the other way.
Let's talk about experience, because I think that's a big thing that Tim Ryan and his campaign bring up. And critics will say that you have no experience in politics. You're starting off, and instead of running for some local race or Congress, you're running for a U.S. Senate seat. So why are you confident that you're the man for the job?
Well, I don't have experience in politics, but I do have experience creating jobs. My companies and my firm have created close to 1,000 jobs just in the state of Ohio and other jobs elsewhere. I think that we have, you know, different levels of experience that all of us bring to the table. And I think bringing experience as a job creator, as a husband, as a father, as somebody who's actually had to sign the front of a paycheck, not just the back of a paycheck, I think those things are helpful in figuring out how we legislate and create an environment where all of our workers and all of our families can thrive. Given what's gone on in Washington, D.C., not a whole lot of bipartisanship, not a whole lot of legislating gone on in Washington, not just the last few years, the last 20 years, I think being a creature of Washington, D.C., spending 20 years in that place, as Tim Ryan has done, not being able to get anything done, that's not the experience we need. We need the experience of people who actually get things done. Whether it's in politics or business, we need go-getters. We need people who get things done. And unfortunately, Tim Ryan's not that guy, but I am.
Let's talk about negative politics here, because we've had a little bit of negative in this conversation. You know, I think aside from the really important things like inflation and abortion and those issues, voters are so turned off by the negativity. And we see it in both of your ads, frankly, right?
Sure.
What do you say to those voters who say, I don't like such and such ad that he put out there. I'm not voting for him. Are you going to change things? Will you truly be able to reach across the aisle? Because I do think most of the people in my inner circle, whether they're left or whether they're right, the majority of us, 85%, really are kind of in the middle on most things.
Of course. Yeah, you know, I guess I think that, you know, like, I don't like negative ads either. I don't like the negativity of our politics. I would much rather talk about our records and what we want to do for the people of Ohio. But when you have a campaign like Tim Ryan's that's gone so aggressively negative so early, remember, we didn't run an ad until months into the election, and the first ad that we ran was a very positive ad, but you've got to respond when people attack your record. And that's all we've really done, is we've tried to say, look, here are the things I believe, here are the things Tim Ryan has done. We've tried to at least keep it on the substance. Yes, sometimes these things are more negative than they should be, but we've at least kept it on the substance. What we haven't done is lied about Tim Ryan's background. We haven't thrown mud at Tim Ryan's prior achievements. We just said, look, he's voted this way, he said he believes these things, and there's something that doesn't match about those two pictures. That's all we've really done, and I think at the end of the day, that's justified, especially given how aggressively negative the other side has been.
And if you win in November, are you going to be able, will you be willing to work with the Biden administration?
Of course I can. Yeah, of course I can. I mean, politics is a contact sport. It's not for the faint-hearted. I certainly think, you know, my wife gets more upset about these negative ads than anybody, and she's my wife. And I think, you know, it's much easier as the candidate, I think, to take some of this stuff than it is for the family. But I think at the end of the day, it's if you have principles, and you have a very clear idea of what you want to get done, you ought to be willing to work with anybody to get those things done. So for example, I think that we need to really open up American energy exploration. We need to finish the Keystone XL pipeline. My guess is, especially if we have a Republican Congress, Joe Biden's going to be willing to work with us on that stuff. At least I hope so. My guess, at least my hope, is that on closing down the southern border, stopping the flow of illegal drugs, Joe Biden is maybe going to be willing to work with Republicans. So, I think there are things you can do. There are things that you can do to work across the aisle to get things done. And look, I'm not opposed to giving something up, right? I'm fine with a good piece of legislation. I don't need everything to be perfect. I just want to make things better for this state. And at the end of the day, crime is too high. The border's in crisis. We have a terrible price problem, an inflation problem. We need to do something, and we need to make people's lives better. And I think I'm the guy to do that.
We want to thank J.D. Vance for taking the time to talk with us. Tomorrow night at 7:30, we're going to bring you our sit-down interview with Vance's opponent, Democratic candidate Tim Ryan. And we'll also be posting this full interview in our 2022 election guide on our website.